அதுல கன்ஃபியூஷன் தான் இருக்கணும் சார், அப்பதான் கிளாரிட்டி வரும். நத்திங் ராங்
சார். வி ரிக்வெஸ்ட் அவர் ஜட்ஜ் நாகேந்திரன் டு கிவ் அ ஸ்மால் இன்ட்ரடக்ஷன் அபவுட் அவர் ஸ்பீக்கர் சார். Unable to hear you, sir.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So, good evening to all. Ellarku namaskara. And Devi Bhagavatam kekkarathu evvalavu sandoshamo, adhe alavu sandosham to introduce the person who is going to talk to us about Devi Bhagavatam. I am a blessed soul to introduce a great person like Dr. C.L. Ramakrishnan. And for giving me this opportunity, I thank our doctor, Dr. A.G. Ramesh. Namaskar, sir. Thank you. It's not that Dr. C.L. requires formal introduction because he is known in all spheres of life, be it academic, be it career, be it award, be it general, sports, and all fields, he is very well known. And it is my pleasure to say a few words about him by way of introducing to all of us. Born on 1st December 1934, Dr. Ramakrishnan obtained his BA degree with chemistry and physics. So he is going to tell us about the chemistry of being in Adhyatma or Anmikam, and then how it will improve our physics also. So with that training at graduate level, he entered the Indian Police Service through UPSC in 1959. I was a small kid then. And after his service, when it was almost coming to end, he did his MA in Sanskrit from Tirupati University. And at that age, he passed it with first class and first rank. And later, in 1989 to 1998, he did his PhD work and got his doctoral degree from Pondicherry University, working on Advaita Vedanta. And there is no need to tell that it was so highly commended, his PhD work. He worked from 1954 to 55 as assistant chemist in the then Madras State silk industry, and then served as a high school teacher in Kerala Educational Service. And he joined in 1956 and worked till 59 in AG's office at Madras. After passing his IPS through UPSC, as I told, he was holding all these posts, and then he joined the police department in 1959. During his tenure of service in the police department, he has held various positions ranging from assistant superintendent of police, superintendent of police, DIG, IG, and then retired as Director of Vigilance and Anti-Corruption, holding the rank of DGP. He retired on 30/11/1992, with over 33 years of extremely disciplined and distinguished service. And this includes his service as CBI, as SP and DIG for over 13 years. And awards came his way. He never went behind them. Not one, several of them. For paucity of time, I just mention a few. He was awarded the Police Medal for Meritorious Service by the President of India in 1977. And he was also awarded President's Medal for Distinguished Service in 1985. Rotary Club Chennai honored him with, for the sake of honor, Award in 1994, and which he was awarded again in 2011. The Narayan Iyer Memorial Trust Lifetime Achievement Award was given to him in 2014, the first ever during the Silver Jubilee year of the Trust, for his immense contribution to Sanskrit studies and studies on Indian culture. The Manonmaniam Sundaranar University, Srinalveli, honored him with the first ever Justice V.R. Krishnayyar Memorial Award for integrity in 2014. What a great moment it should have been for him to receive this V.R. Krishnayyar Memorial Award. Such a great legal luminary of not just our country, of the whole world. And to talk about other achievements of Dr. C.R. R., he played cricket and football at the university level. And he is a great lover of Carnatic music. And he is a faculty in many institutions, handling classes on management topics, law, vigilance, discipline, ethics, conduct rules, investigation of fraud cases, prevention of corruption act, and he also is in police administration for postgraduate students of Madras University. On the spiritual side, with which he is going to treat us this evening, he gives discourses on Vedanta, Itihasa, Purana in Chennai and other parts of Tamil Nadu. It is not just with pleasure, it is with great reverence that I introduce him to the audience today, and I consider it as my greatest moment in my life. Romba namaskaram sir, unga aashirvaadangal ellarkum. Sir, you can start your discourse, sir.
Thank you, sir. I'm humbled by all these things, sir. Whatever you have told, I don't know whether I deserve all that. It's all God's grace, good wishes for people like you, blessings of elders, and all those who are well disposed to me. I don't know what great work I have done. But these things have come, God's grace and all this. I bow down to all of you for remembering me, and I only request one thing, that I must have increase in my knowledge. That's what I want. All these things are okay for worldly things. So there are two lives we have, one for our existence and one for our non-existence in future. The existence, all these things are okay. The non-existence are moksha. That is the Paramapurusharta, which is a little superior to all these things. I am standing for that, and I want all your good wishes, elders' blessings, Guru's blessings and all that. Now with this we start now. One sloka last I cited regarding this Guru Vandanam is actually a summary of Devi Bhagavata. It is there in the Devi Bhagavata text, which means that Goddess is superior to all. All others are actually servants in various areas. The superiority of Devi, that is what is indicated here. The very interesting way in which all these factors, including the Brahma Sutra summary and also Upanishadic summary, have been given in this sloka. Srishto, that is in creation. So that is, we think, Brahma's duty, but now this is Amba's duty. Srishtau ya sarvarupa, various types of forms and names in this world. They come from creation. And who is responsible? The Upar is responsible. That is in protection. Who is responsible? Vishnu, normally we say, but here again Ambal. Yacha raudri samharita. When completely the whole thing is consumed at the time of the pralaya, again, it is Ambal. Yasyaha jagadhi idam akilam kridanam. This is what the Brahma Sutra says. Logavattu lila kaivalyam. So it is an example of that. Lokavartu Leela Kaivalya. It's only Leela. There is no effort for Ambal for doing all these things. And Paishyanti, Madhyama, and then Vaikari, they are the three stages of producing the sound. All these are of Varna Rupa. Varna here means letters or the language or the speech. So these are the three. So Asmadu Vajam Prasanna, let her make my speech or my presentation clear. Who is Vidhi Hari Girisha Aradita? She is adored by Vidhi Brahma, Hari Srimanarayana, and Girisha, that is Lord. Girisha is different, Girisha is different. Girav Shede Dasmat Girisha. One who has got the abode of mountain as his place to sleep. Girisha means Himavan. That is the Lord of the mountains. Girisha. There is no Girga here. Girisha Aradhita Alankarotu. So with that prayer, we start. Now the salutations and thanks to all of you and especially to Doctor, because he is the instrument for my coming here and talking to you. And in a way, encouraging me to reduce my ignorance. Now the topic is Devi Bhagavatam, a very, very wide book. 118,000 slokas are there. So it may require perhaps 18,000 days to speak about this wonderful book. So what I have given title is a sketchy bird's eye view, not even a bird's eye view. Sketchy bird's eye view of Devi Bhagavatam. You know there are 18 Puranas and there are 18 Upapuranas, subsidiary Puranas. This word 8, this letter or number 18 is highly significant in Sanatana Dharma. Because number of things are indicated by 18. Mahabharata has got 18 books. Parvas they call it. Bhagavad Gita has got 18 chapters and it mentions 18 qualifications, the slogans 55 to 72 in chapter 2 of an ideal person. It also speaks about 18 qualities, body, manas, etc., etc. And then you have got 18 steps to reach Ayyappa's sanctum sanctorum. And Vedavyasa has got these 18 vidyas also. That's why in Malayalam they say, Padicha Padanattam Paravikanam. Padanat is 18. That is all knowledge. It is compendium of everything. But finally, the most important significance of this word 18 is because of Kadapayadi calculation. This is the one that originated in Kerala, they say. Kadapayadi calculation means the number is given to each letter. And the order of arrangement of the letter, the value is reversed. So when you say 18, it means Jaya. That is, 1 is Ya and 8 is Ja. But you reverse it and make it Jaya. So victory. 18 relates to victory. Victory means what? Not the material victory. That can be achieved by your ability in this world. But this is not the victory intended here. Whenever you talk about Puranas and our philosophy and all that, this material takes a secondary level. Of course, it is necessary. That's why the Mundaka Upanishad says, Dve Vidye Vedideviye Paracha Aparacha. Two Vidyas are necessary, one the lower one, one the higher one. Lower one is for subsistence survival. And unless you survive, you can't progress in spiritual path. Shariram Adhyam Kalu Dharma Sadhanam. So for that it is necessary. But that is not the be-all and end-all of existence. Therefore, Dve Vidye Vedideviye. Two Vidyas are to be acquired. Para and Apara. Para is superior, Apara is less important. Not that unimportant, less important. Comparatively less important. So 18 is a very, very significant number that indicates victory. Victory not only of the worldly things that is necessary, but then that can perhaps create arrogance in people. Spiritually it is not so. Because when you see the compositions of people like Valmiki or Vyasa or all those gurus that we have got, the guru parampara, then we know that we are nowhere. So that is what the spirituality confers. So Devi Bhagavata Mahapurana consists of 18,000 verses. And they are normally rendered in Navaha or 9 days. Just like 18,000 slogans of Srimad Bhagavata, that is rendered in Saptaha or 7 days. There are 7 days because it denotes what Parishit was subjected to by Sukhasasya in 7 days. Because the curse was there that Parishit will be bitten by snake fatally on the 7th day. So this is the comparison between the two. Devi Mahatmyam is a part of Devi Bhagavatam. Devi Bhagavata has got 18,000 slokas. 18,000. In Srimad Bhagavata, there is one difference. Srimad Bhagavata consists not only of slokas. There are also prose passages there. Certain places are written in prose. But in Devi Bhagavatam, the entire thing is in poetic composition. Wherever there is a combination of prose and poetry, that combination is called champu. Garjya Bhajya Ubayamayi Champuji Chabijayate goes the definition. So now here, the arrangement of the text here is for spiritual and also material and religious. All the three are there. The Sanatana Dharma accepts it, the three-tier system. Therefore, we have the Vedas, that is the supreme, and then we come back to the Puranas, and then we come to the literature or the work of the poets. Kavya. Kavya means kavehe karma kavyam. It can be prose, it can be poetry, or it can be combination of both. Now, but all the three can be the same matter. Do I continue or any other intervention? No. Am I to answer these questions now or at the end? Not clear. I'm not able to clear. Audible is not clear. I can't understand. Oh. Or you can post it here if there is a procedure. I can read that question and give you the answer. I'm not able to understand clearly. So unless I understand the question, I will not be able to answer.
Sir, those who want to answer the questions, please have it in the end. Please do not disrupt the speech, sir. Sorry to say this.
No, it will help me because the flow of thought will be there. And if you don't mind, I don't mind your asking in between, but it will be helpful to me if you ask at the end. Because I would have finished my presentation. And then if necessary, you can note down or post it or I don't know, whatever you can do. Mechanisms are there. I'm not too familiar with this. All this is done by my wife. I have no idea about this technology. So, I would request you to have it at the end. Or if there is no time, you can even post me an email. I can give you a reply, whatever it is. I leave it to you. I don't mind being disturbed. But then, others may not feel very comfortable. Because if you have a flow, it will be easy for us logically to understand the argument. And anyway, choice is with you. I am game for both. Now, I want to tell you the summary of how things are, very tight system. Whatever the Vedas say, they are only said in the Puranas, and the same thing in the works of the prophets. But only the way in which it is said. Vedas give you a command. There is no question of argument on that. This is what is called Prabhu Samhita. It is a command. But then when it comes to the Shastras or Puranas, it is like a friend advising you. The Sukhrit Samhita, they call it. Sukhrit Samhita. But when the poets are writing, they write in a pleasing manner, employing figures of speech, meters and all that, which are very attractive. And that is called Kanta Samhita. Like wives advising husbands. So this is, but anyway, the question is same. The matter is same.
Ultimately, the aim of all these works, starting from the Vedas to all the Kavyas, is only for upliftment of human beings in their conduct, ethics and behavior, so that in this very life itself, they should be able to attain moksha. Because that is supposed to be the target. Purusharthas are four, dharma, artha, kama, moksha. But dharma, artha and kama are not supposed to lead you to liberation. They are all steps that lead you to the ultimate called jnana. Of course, there is a diversion. There are the schools of philosophy, that is, Vishishtadvaita and Dvaita. They say not necessary to have jnana. In fact, jnana leads to bhakti. That is their argument. But Advaitins argue, no, bhakti is in the middle. And that is proved by the text Veda and also in summary the text Bhagavad Gita. Disturbance in that. Now, in between is bhakti in both. You find in the Vedas, first is the Karma Kanda, and then comes the Upasana Kanda, and then comes the Jnana Kanda. The Gita also, you find the Karma Yoga, the Bhakti Yoga, and the Jnana Yoga. Therefore, the bhakti is what is called Madhya Mani Nyaya. You have a light in between two rooms, both rooms are lit. There's no need for separate light. So, for doing karma also you need bhakti. And for getting jnana also you need bhakti. Bhakti will lead to moksha, but according to Advaita concept, through jnana only. That's why Bhagavad Pada says repeatedly, whatever may be the effect you are making, unless you have got jnana, there's no question of getting liberation. Jnanad eva tu kaivalyam. That is the argument. Anyway, these are the things that are step for us. Veda is difficult to understand, though in Sanskrit we want to have a commentary, we want to have a adhyabhaga to tell you. The normal reading will not be possible to understand that. Puranas are little better because they tell you stories and the moral of the story we can try to apply and understand the principles in Veda. But then persuasively the Kavyas give you all these Vedic concepts and the principles that are embedded in them by interesting stories, not only that, using figures of speech and meters and all that. That's why, though the Puranas are there, they are classified as Shaiva Puranas, Vaishnava Puranas, and also Shakta Puranas. 18 Puranas are divided into three. Some extol Sriman Narayana, some extol Lord Shiva, some extol Goddess. Now, then what is the real thing? If you go into that, contextually, wherever it is necessary, one of these powers, whether it is Narayana or Shiva or Ambal, they are given the precedent and preeminent position. That follows a simple rule, Nashi Ninda Nyaya. That is, there is no question of insulting anybody. But at that time, for that context, that is important. For example, today, I am making a presentation within my own limitation. But then all of you say, all right, this man is that man, and all that, you give me a lot of praise. I may not deserve that, but you are about to give it to me, whether you like it or not, whether I deserve it or not. This is called Nakinda Nyaya. When I come here, suppose you praise somebody else. I know in this audience there are many people who are more knowledgeable, but you can't praise them today, at this moment. This is what is called Nahinanda Nyaya. Like that, Brahma sometimes, Vishnu sometimes, Shiva sometimes, Ambal sometimes. It is not that others are inferior or insignificant. In context, this is important. That's why Kalidasa says in Kumara Sambhava, in Canto 7, Sloka 44, he says all the three are same energy used for creation, preservation and dissolution. There is no difference. Energy is same. Energy can create, matter is inert. Energy can create, energy can make it stay, or if energy is not there, the matter holds up. Energy is same. Whether it is fan or it is a motor car or whatever, the energy is same. Only thing is the matter is either activated this way or that way, or is maintained, or perhaps energy is not there, matter is enough. This is what he says. Ekaiva murtihi vivide tridasa. There's only one murti that split into three. And samanya mesam prathama avaratvam. It is very common that you find that. Prathama avara. One is senior, one is junior, one is more powerful, one less powerful. One is master, one is servant. All these things are common. Samanya mesam. How? Vishnoho haraha tasya harihi kadachit. Vishnoho haraha. Sometimes you find Lord Shiva super than Vishnu. Sometimes Vishnu superiorly painted than Shiva. Vedaha tayoho. Sometimes Brahma better than these two or more than these two. And sometimes Daduhu, Brahma lower than all the three. So this is common, he says. And it depends upon the context and also the job or the operational area. So therefore, here, when we say the Devi Bhagavata Purana is glorifying Shakti, it does not mean that others are belittled. This Purana is about Devi, and therefore, preeminent position has to be given to Devi. And here, what the Upanishad says is the running trend. Creation, sustenance, and also dissolution. This is why I gave you the Prarthana Sloka and also the meaning earlier. What is the support for this? Taittiriya Upanishad, there is a Vakya. That refers to what is called Brahman in an indirect way. What they call as Tatastha Lakshana, not the Swarupa Lakshana. Swarupa Lakshana is Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma. It's very difficult to understand all this. Therefore, the Upanishad gives you an indirect way of understanding. Tadastha means Tadaya Tishtati, that which is there on the way. A common example will be, if you go to a village and you want to know the house of X, Y, or Z there, you ask somebody, where is the house of so-and-so? They will point out by saying, there's a crow sitting there, that is the house. The crow will not permanently sit there. For the moment it will sit there, that is enough for you to understand. That is what is called Tadastha Lakshana. So, Taittiriya Upanishad gives that. Yato vayumani bhutani jayante, yena jatani jivanti, yat prayanti abhisambhisanti, tat vijiknyasaswa, tat brahmeti. So a question, what is the definition of Brahman, which cannot be defined, because anirvachaniyatva, then they say, from where everything issues out, by what everything is sustained and preserved, and into which everything lapses at the time of the great floods, or seek to know thou that to be Brahman. Yatova imani bhutani jayante yena jatani jivanti yat prayanti abhisambhisanti tat vijiknyasaswa tat brahmeti. So this is the principle used in explaining the prowess of Shakti or Ambal in this Devi Bhagavata Purana. Now, the undercurrent in this text is Advaita concept, though there is a large dose of bhakti also in it. Well, this is inseparable. You know, Advaita means ekam eva advitiyam. One and one only. Ekam, but eva, and then advitiyam. Ekam itself is strong enough. Then you supplement with eva, and again further reinstate and reinforce in advitiyam. One and one only. This is, what about others? Earlier we saw in that Mangala Sloka itself, they're all forms and names. Forms and names are not permanent. They are there for a time. Maybe a time may be a very large interval, but that doesn't mean it is permanent. So that's why whatever is non-permanent cannot be considered to be Brahman. So, ekam eva, simple rule in Advaita. Vishishta Advaita says, one in many, and many in one. What they call a sharira shariri bhava, or shesha sheshi bhava. One there, but it is there in others. All others are also one. It is something in between Advaita and Dvaita. Vishishta Advaita is something between that. That's why it's called Vishishta Advaita.
has got some visheshan. Then Dvaita, they clearly say not only two, there are five. We call it prapancha. The universe is called prapancha. The meaning given by them is pancha veda. There are five differences. God is different from jiva. One jiva different from another jiva. Jiva different from inner things. One inner thing different from another inner thing. So, God different from jiva, number one. All jivas are not saying that. And jiva is different from inert objects. And inert objects are different from God. And between two inert objects, they are also different. Individuality. This is what they say. But one common point between Vishishta Advaita and Dvaita is, they say moksha or liberation from the cyclic existence of the soul comes from bhakti, not jnana. And they subordinate jnana to bhakti. This is their argument. But otherwise, it says nothing doing. Bhakti is only a path. Karma, bhakti, jnana. That is what the Vedas represent. That is what Bhagavad Gita, which is the essence of all the sutis, that also represent. That is what it is. So, jiva and Brahma, that is the subject here. And that is identical, or rather, non-different. Now, detailed discussion on these matters may not be relevant in this context of dealing with Devi Bhagavata. Just I indicated what is the thread that runs through the text. All the texts praise the glory of Devas in their own way. Nothing wrong. But here in this book we find the glory of Ambal or Devi is there. So it is same actually. Without energy, matter is inert. So, one point I would like to mention here, Bhagavad Pada, author of Saundarya Lakshmi and actually incarnation of Lord Shiva, he starts it in a very powerful way to show what he said in this Devi Bhagavata. Shiva Shaktya Yuktaha Yidhi Bhavadi Shakta Prabhavitam Naje Devam Devaha Bhavadi Kusalas Panditumabhi. Now, see the language. Shivaha Shaktya Yuktaha Yadi Shaktaha Prabhavitam Bhavadi Naje Devam Shri Nasho Sadevaha Shivaha Nabhavadi Kusalaha Panditumabhi. Only in the association of Shakti, he is able to do whatever he is doing. In that absence, he cannot even move. He will stay stuck. This is the powerful language used. And who says this is? Bhagavad Pada. And who was Bhagavad Pada? Lord Shankara's incarnation. Sambhor Murtihi Saradibhuvane Shankara Chajya Rupa. Now what other certification is necessary? While the text deals with Advaita Vedanta also, there is a large dose of bhakti or devotional worship of the goddess. Usually it is argued that Advaita and bhakti are contradictory. It is not so because the sloka in Srimad Bhagavata is very clear. Atma Ramascha Munayaha Nirgrandhavi Urukrame Kurvandi Ahaitugim Bhaktim Chittam Buddha Munogadihi. Nirgrandaha, that is people who have no attachment at all to anything, completely avoid the concept in the sense they don't worry about the material things, they concentrate only on the essential reality. They themselves do a lot of bhakti because that is the quality of the Lord. Kurvandi Ahaitugim Bhaktim. So one adjective, Ahaituki. Ahaituki means bhakti for bhakti's sake, like Prasada. Or the Alvars, or the nine Mars. Bhakti for bhakti only, not to get anything else. Because then you are bargaining something far inferior than what is the aim of bhakti, namely moksha. So there is no conflict at all on that. And this Advaiti concept of Ahaituki bhakti is mentioned in the 10th skanda, 11th adhyaya and 12th sloka. In the Devi Bhagavata, he speaks about this type of bhakti. Now, just to have a
side interest of this, or a sideline, Srimad Bhagavata was narrated to Parikshit by Shishuka in 7 days, 18,000 slokas. And Devi Bhagavatam was narrated by Sri Shuka's father, Vyasa, to Parikshit's son, Janamejaya, at the Sarpayajna. Also 18,000 slokas. So, Srimad Bhagavata by Shuka to Parikshit, Devi Bhagavata by Shuka's father to Parikshit's son. Obviously, there is some connection and some commonality and similarity. And the case of many of the Sanskrit works, Vedas, Puranas, works and all that, we do not know the date. Sometimes there is a conjecture, sometimes there is a statement without much of basis, sometimes for the authors also. Why? Because they thought that knowledge is not theirs. In fact, that is the truth. Whatever knowledge a person gains is not his. We have got the authority on the Brahma Sutra, Shastra Yonitvat. All Shastras have their source in only the Lord. We find in the Vishnu Sahasranama, Sloga 139 also, Yoga Jnanam Tata Sankhyam Vidya Shilpadi Karmaja, Veda Shastrani Vijnanam, all these, Yedasaram Janardhanath, all these come only from the Lord. Therefore, they did not want to say that I have said it, and therefore they remained anonymous. Maybe it's a nice point also when you go into the history of all these things and these persons. Anyway, that is a fact. Thus, dating of the Puranas is fraught with all sorts of difficulty. But one thing can be said. Srimad Ramayana was the Adikavya and all others came late. The only thing that can say with some sort of emphasis. Because Ramayana contains all these things, but none of these contain Ramayana. Is the only point. All poets and writers have referred to Ramayana, but Valmiki does not refer to any of these things. So there is maybe one reason we can say that Ramayana was a forerunner. We call it Adikavya and also Valmiki Adikavi. Now this text of Devi Bhagavata consists of 12 books and they consist of 3 divisions. Mythology, Metaphysics and Bhakti. Books 1 to 6 speak about mythology. And the mythology is, as all of us know, in all the books, there is a perpetual fight between Asuras and Devas. It is symbolism. Sanatana Dharma is lot of symbolism only. We should not take it in the literal meaning. Devas and Asuras are fighting means it is always a perpetual fight between dharma and adharma. And ultimately, dharma wins. That is the lesson that we draw, not fight. For they have got some personalities there, some qualities there, some stories are there, episodes are there, it's all okay. But what is the actual fight there? It is only a fight between dharma and adharma, and which finally sustains. Adharma, whatever it is, however strong it cannot suppress dharma. So symbolism, that is what is described here. The good and bad, the ultimate victory is the good, and the lessons that one has to draw. This is mythological reference in first 6 books. It contains 18 books, 18,000 slogas also. Not 1,000 slogas to book, but then that is the total number, 1 to 6. 7 to 9 deal with metaphysics. Philosophy dealing with the nature of existence, truth and knowledge. This is the 7, 8 and 9 books. Then 10 and 12, they deal with the nature, splendor, etc. of goddess and she is the ultimate refuge. There is also a reference to the prapancha or universe and the concept of dharma, which is the very base of existence. The word dharma itself is that. And very difficult to define dharma. We saw earlier in the Yaksha Prashna, when the Krishna asked to Dharmaputra by Yaksha, what is the definition of dharma? He said it's not possible to define that. Because it is laid very deep in the Shastras, it is not possible to understand. So, how do you follow dharma if that question arises?
follow what great people have done who have gone before you. Support of Bhagavad Gita, Yajyadadari Srestaha, Tata Devi Darodhanaha, Sai Pramanam Gurude, Logastha Danuvartade. So you take that as the leaders and also as the role models and follow that. What Rama did, what Krishna did, in that circumstance, at that time, that is Dharma. Today, in hindsight, we may have a difference of opinion. That's why we say that this superiority or praising some god at some point of time does not mean there's insult to others or that doesn't show the others in poorer light. Not like that area, that time, that context, that has to be taken. So now we may see a few samples of these three divisions of the text following the concept Sali Bulaga Nyaya. Sali Bulaga Nyaya in Sanskrit is known in Tamil as Urubana Shoruk Uru Shoru Padam. Of course, the pane should have equally cooking everything. One side is burnt, one side is not cooked and all that. That is not the correct example. Uniformly cooked, if it is there, then every small grain of rice there will have the same level of cooking. Stali Pulaka Nyaya. So like that, because as I said, 18,000 slokas in 1 hour, no. 18,000 days we want. Then only we can understand the concept there, the commentaries on that. Then whatever doubts are there, debates are there, it will be a fruitful thing. So I make a very simple survey, not only survey, sketchy survey. So books 1 and 6, the first book is introduction of the content, as usual. Because in any book, there are three things one should read. It opens by saying, this book contains this. In middle, they make a review, and the end, they conclude. This is what is called Upakrama and Madhya and Upasamahara. For all texts, this is the rule. What is it that the author intends to tell you? That is the first one. So that if you are interested, you can read. Not interested, you can close the book. Or is going to be useful to you, you will be interested. Otherwise, why read that? So they give you what is called a panoramic view, first itself. That is what is called Upakrama. What is it? Introduction. A little detailed introduction about that. Then in between, they give you up to what you have come and then make a review of that. And finally, they summarize the whole thing. Because generally, it is understood that whatever you hear or read in the last moment only sticks to your memory. Suppose you listen to a lecture for 3 hours. The last sentence alone or last idea alone or the concept alone will stick to you. All others will be superimposed by this. This is what happened. Unless you are so powerful to remember all that, like Shatavadani or Dashavadani and things like that. Very difficult. Last one, first impression, the best impression is what the proverb says. But our experience is last impression is the best impression. This is what happened. So this is what we find in all books. Narayani, for example, the other day we saw. It starts with the same word, Ananda. In middle, Ananda. In the end, also Ananda. That shortly indicates the Brahma Tattva or the Brahma Swarupa. Because the content is that. So this is the way in which it starts the first book. The third book is, it extends to the second book also. The third book is on bhakti for the goddess. Bhakti for the goddess. The sloka, I will quote one sloka here as example. Sali Vilaga Nyaya, I told you, number of slokas are there. It requires a lot of detailed study. So I just show one sloka. Smrda Sampujita Bhaktya Janene Uccharida Satu Dadadi Vankitartana Karyadanena Kirtyate. This is 3.11.49. Smrta, that is Smarana. You remember Prahlada's statement, Shravanam Kirtanam Vishnuhu Smaranam. Going on, contemplation, meditation, cogitation, Smarana, Sampujita. Pujana, Bhaktya. Bhakti is emotional addiction to the Lord. Addiction, that is Bhakti. Not casually or part-time sort of thinking and all that. Now the question is whether it's possible to do that. Answer is given by saying, if you are involved like that continuously, all other things also you carry out, but Bhakti will be as an undercurrent in you. Some people question, is it possible? Only one thing at a time you can do. How can you do this? Then the simple answer they give is, see gopis. They did not have formal training in any of these things, but they are always thinking of Lord only while doing all their work also. Now you may say, no, gopis are a different matter, sir. I am not of that level. Then they will give you a worldly example. Even today you can see that. What is that example? A girl who is dancing with a pot on her head. Karagam dance, we call it in Tamil Nadu. She is having a pot on her head and she is dancing. She is not doing one or two things. First thing she does is watches whether all people are appreciating her dance. Number two, there is a music behind or background for which she gives the abhinaya. Then there is a drum beat or something. Then she has the footfalls according to the rhythm or the drum. But these three are unimportant. Appreciation of public, her own abhinaya, or her own keeping pace with the drum beat for the steps, they are not important. Most important thing is, she is careful that the pot on her head does not fall. Now she is doing four things. So is it not possible for you to do two things? Whenever you are doing something, make it an offering to Lord. Always think of Lord and do that. That is how bhakti gets enriched and entrenched in the person. This is what is said to be the bhakti yoga. Yoga, yoga means the word yuji, to unite. That which joins you. And bhakti joins you along with that. Not separate. God is there, I am here, something is there, this is not bhakti. Bhakti means you are one with that. So this is the way in which bhakti is described. And here you find in the third book, a sloka which speaks about the various limbs of bhakti. Smarana is there, sampujana is there, and dhyana is there, and uccharita means recitation of whatever the gunas of the Lord, whatever sarsanama or whatever it is, and also vanchidartham it gives. What is that vanchidartham? Vanchidartham is the desired result. For any human being, what is the ultimate desired result? Not anything which is ephemeral. What is lasting happiness? What is bliss? That is the vanchidartham. So, they give you step by step something here to satisfy you to start with. Thereafter you find they are all no good. Then you come to the level of what is really happy or present state of mind. So, all these they give. So, bhakti also leads to moksha according to this sloka. So there are arguments that are possible in the other systems of Vedanta also, which can rely on slokas like this. But there is no quarrel about that. Advaita does not quarrel about that. It says bhakti is necessary. But that is not the end. That's all what Advaita can say. It goes beyond. Then the third book, there are 16 or 17 slokas which glorify what is the opulence of the Lord or the Goddess here. The fourth and fifth deal with the supremacy of the Devi. In the words of Vyasa, the author of the text, this is the sloka. One sloka I am quoting. Ya mata sarva devanam yagavau yagadau parikirtita maji mata idi vikhyada namna kena kurudvaha. He is telling the people who are assembled there. What is she? Buddhihi, kirtihi, dridihi, lakshmihi, Shaktihi, Shraddha, Madihi, Smritihi. Sarvesham, Praninam, Sa. What is the Pratyaksham Vai Vibhasate? Sarvesham, Praninam, Sa. Pratyaksham Vibhasate. Meaning, she is there, embedded in all the Pranis. Prana is living being. You can extend it to saying inner things also. Everything comes from there. Everything has got the quality of the Lord. And one sloka later, Brahma Vishnu Tada Shambhu Vasavaha Varunaha Yamaha Vayuhu Agnihi Kuberaha Tvashta Pusa Ashinu Bhagaha Adityaha Vasavaha Rudraha Vishvedevaha Marudganaha Sarve Jayanditam Devim Srishti Stiti Andakarinim 318, 30, 34.
Now, all these are list of the celestials, including the Trinity and all the lesser gods and all that. Finally, Sarve Dhyayanti Tam Devim. So, the supremacy of Goddess by making all these subjugated. Srishti, and what is the function? Srishti, Sthiti, Andhagari. So, creation, sustenance, and also dissolution. So, that's how first six books deal with it. I am only taking here and there one or two. I know I am not doing justice to the text, but within the time available, and also the time you can spare, I can spare, though it's not very correct, but still, practically, this is all that is possible. Right. The second set, 7 to 9, metaphysical. The seventh book has got Devi Gita, very interesting word. There are more than 30-40 Gitas in our books. In the Mahabharata itself, we have got 30-32 Gitas. And Bhagavata, you have got Gitas. Puranas, you have got Gitas. So, Gita is a common word. But when you say Gita, generally, you refer to Bhagavad Gita. Just like Gayatri. All gods have got Gayatri. Gayatri is only a composition in three lines, eight syllables, 24 letters. That is Gayatri. That is a meter. Gayatri is a meter in the Vedas. But that is not the name of any composition actually. But we use it like that. But when you say Gayatri, you generally mean only Surya Gayatri. But Gayatri is there, plenty of Gayatri. 33 crores of gods, you have got Gayatri. Like that here also. Gita does not mean that it's Bhagavad Gita. But though you use it, because it's more popular, and we are reading it much more than these Gitas. All texts have got some Gita there. Gita has got only 3 points. Number one, it gives you only spiritual knowledge. Number two, it has to be sung. Jayam Gita, Nama Sahasram, Bhagavata says in the Vajagovinda. Gita is that. It is a song. You mean song, they write in English, song. Number two, it speaks about only jnana. And it is a secret given by the guru to his shishya. You find the Bhagavad Gita sloga, Tasmat Shastram Pramanam Teji. And what is that? Gushya, Gushyataram Maya. Gushya is secret, Gushyataram is more secret. Tasmat, you should attend it carefully, understand it completely, and practice it for your progress. That is the indication there. Secret. It cannot be just a tom-tom for everybody, because in the Gita, in Bhagavad Gita itself, you find last chapter, the Moksha Sannyasa Yoga, the closing stages, Lord tells, this Gita is to be told only for people who are interested in that, not for people who abuse or makes derogatory remarks and all that. For people who are not having any faith, don't try to tell them all these things. Lord tells that. So like that, here you find Devi Gita. 2 points stand out predominantly here. Devi is the supreme reality or the Brahman. And secondly, liberty from the cyclic existence of soul happens when the individual self and the Brahman are identified as non-different. I won't say same. Non-different. There is no difference at all. That is the simple concept in Advaita Bhava. Or Anegatma Bhava is not there. There is only Yegatma Bhava. Anegatma Bhava are because of either reflection or containment. These are the two theories in Advaita Vedanta. Number one is Bimba Pratibimba Vada. Another one is called the Avacheda Vada. One says only one original is there. All others are only images or their reflection. The other one says, only one is there, all others are containing them because there is a container called body. If the body is destroyed, where does it go? Atma. It never goes anywhere because there is no place to go. This is called actually completely occupying the whole universe. Where do it go? There is no place at all. It is something like a big hall divided into 4 or 5 rooms. As it is today, you have got 5 rooms. But you knock out all the walls, what has happened to those rooms? It is something like that. This is what is called containment theory or avachedavada. Or otherwise, you have got one object. You have got two mirrors placed parallel. How many images you will have? Infinity. But they are all not true. Our one sun is there, so many reflections are there. Keep 100 pots of water, 100 suns are there. That is how Vedanta argues. So therefore, non-difference is what is important, not even identity. Identity means you should say two things are there and then try to say they are both the same. That argument also you will not accept. They will say non-different, same. Appears differently or it is contained differently, that's all. This is the thing rooted in the Advaita Vedanta, which is given in this system, in this book. The Devi Gita is a parallel text to Bhagavad Gita. In fact, all the texts that go under the name Gita have got this. We have got, they are occurring in Ramayana is there, in Mahabharata is there, Purana is there. All the concepts are there, which are secret. But in Ramayana, they don't say Gita, but the concepts. Like that here also, you find 31 to 34 slogans of 7th book. Slogans 31 to 34. These sections or adhyayas on the 7th book are called Devi Gita. And Devi Gita, one sloka only, I will read here. Man maya shakti sangliptam jagatsarvam charajaram sabhimattaha pridang maya nasteva paramattadaha saham sarvam jagatsrashta tadandaha pravishyamyaham maya karma visahita gire pranaburastata yavaharudu soyam vidya mayedi vishuda tatudrishtyadu nasteva tatvameva avashishtati vyavaharadisha vidya maya. In vyavahara, that is empirical experience, all these things appear to be there due to my maya. But tatvadisha tatvam, if that is the taking, nasti, there is nothing, no difference, everything is one. Now you find in the commentary of Madhusudana Saraswati on the Bhagavad Gita, the very same explanation. He starts the introduction to the commentary, it's called Gudartha Deepika. Gudartha Deepika means a light which will show you clearly what is embedded deep in the text. Gudartha Deepika, Madhusudana Saraswati. He writes there that Bhagavad Gita is actually explanation of the Mahavakya Tattvamasi, but a little disjoint. Tattvamasi is the Mahavakya in the Samaveda. But Bhagavad Gita is Tvam Tadasi, not Tattvamasi. Same thing, but one word is here, the other word is there. Tadri Tvamasi, Tvam Tadasi. Because the text is like that. First six chapters of Bhagavad Gita are Tvam Padartha, self. Next six is called Tatpadartha Brahman. And last Asi, 13 to 18, is non-difference. Tatradu Pradame Kante Bhagavad Gidayam Tatradu Pradame Kante Tvampadartho Vishuddhatma Swabhavati Nirupyate. Tvampadartha, that is self, is explained. So Upavati with examples and all. Dvidiyetu in 7 to 12. Second middle portion. Tatpadartha avatarite. What is Tatpadartha? Bhagavan Paramanandaha. That is what is shown. And Tridiyetu, in the last 13 to 18, Tayoho Aityam, Vakyatam, Vakyatam, what happened? Vanyade Sputam. So that is the summary. Like that, here also we find that all the three are mentioned here in this sloka. This is the quotation from Devi Gita, 31 to 34 of the book. And here also, there are all Gitas will say like that. And very interestingly, very close reading of both. Here and there, one or two words will differ. Otherwise, text also is the same. That is how it goes. And in many places, you find the parallels to Upanishad in the Devi Upanishad also. The meaning of the word Upanishad, of course, Upanishida, sit near me, the Guru says, and the Jikyasa of the student is more important and he gives information for him to understand. Then comes the description of festivals, pilgrimages, etc., rooted in bhakti in the next two books. Why are they described these festivals and pilgrimages? In all these things, there are sacrificial concepts, self-negation and vairagya. This is very necessary as the base for spiritual inquiry. They help one to get detached from the mundane affairs and fix attention to the ultimate reality. In due course, it is necessary. This is why Tirukkural also says that. Patruha, patratran, patrinai. Appatrai patruha, patrutal vidarku. In one line, he gives what is the meaning of that. Patruha, patratran, patrinai. You should resort to that one who has no attachment. Patratran. Patrinai, patruha. That patratran means asangokheyam purushaha is what the Upanishad says. So it's exactly the translation. Patruha, patratran, patrinai. Appatrai patruha, you should do that. What for? Patrudal vidarki. So if you want to have attachment to something, you should have attachment to nothing else. Or you must be of that level of gopis or a jivan mukta who live here, but they are not of it. If that stage is there, it is okay. Otherwise, if you are in one, you cannot be in another. They say you can't have leg in one side and the other leg in other side. No stability will be there. That is why the vasana, it is purva janma vasana, purva janma's vasana also, not one janma, several janma, that make a person get stuck to things. So the vasana kshaya, this is what is recommended by practice of all these things in the Upanishad. And when vasana kshaya goes, there is no contact or there is no attraction for these lower things, the person goes higher in spiritual ladder. 10th Skanda, chapter 9 to 12, briefly deal with the episode in Devi Mahatmya. You will read Devi Mahatmya and also read this book. Very, very close resemblance to the usage of words and the ideas and the whole episode. There are three episodes there in the Devi Mahatmya. Devi Mahatmya is an extraction of Markandeya Purana having 700 slogans. It is also called Mahamaya Saptashati or Devi Saptashati. Sapta, seven, shati, 100. 700 slogans. There are three 700 slogans which are very important in the whole of Sanskrit literature. One is Devi Mahatmya. This is esoteric significance, full of spiritual matter. Then you have got Patanjali Yoga Sutras also. Then you have got one more 700, which is of now not interest. They are all more on lively and life-related matters. But we generally concentrate 700 as only this Saptashati, that is extract of Markandeya Purana. 13 chapters are there, which are supposed to be read during Navaratri. Sometimes they read 7 times per day, or at least they complete it during the Navaratri celebration, 1 or 2 chapters daily. Even otherwise, daily is prescribed to read 1 chapter or 2 chapters as a procedure. In 1 week, you complete that. And it's full of mantra, mantra shastra. Bhaskar Raya gives a commentary on that, explaining every nama of goddess and what it means. A very interesting thing, out of the 700 slogans, there is no sloka which does not contain the two letters, ta and ra. This is what is pointed out by the commentator. Ta, ra. You combine that, you get the word tara. What is the meaning of tara in Sanskrit? Crossover. Taranam. Tara means crossover. What are you going to cross over by reading it? Samsara sagara is to be crossed. So that is how the text is. You find a very close resemblance to the episodes, the words, and also even certain prayogas in peculiar grammatic style in this 10th Skanda, chapters 9 to 12. It's called Devi Mahatmya actually, but the word also appears in the Devi Mahatmya. The word like that here, I can read the sloka for you. Devi Bhagavad 10:10:1. Akarne Mahipala Mahashcharyakaram Param Devi Mahatmyam Atulam Sarvagamapradam Param. Sarva Kama Pradam, the Sarva means all kamas, all desires. But a spiritual seeker will not have desire other than moksha. But anyway, if other things are also, that is satisfied. So, Akarnaya, Mahipala is addressing the king. Dasa is addressing the king. And he says, Mahasharya Garam Param is not Asharya, Mahasharya. And what is that? Devi Mahatmyam Atulam. Incomparable Devi Mahatmyam. This sloga appears in the text 10:10:1. So that is the way in which the book expounds the aradhana of goddess. And there is a elaborate ritual in practice in Kerala called Bhagavati Seva, in which goddess is propitiated with Arshana, Lalita Sahasranama, and Lalita Krishaki. And what is very important there, Mahatmya, Devi Mahatmya is read as a supporting text. And the commentary by Bhaskar Raya is also explained as containing mantra shastra in all these things. I mentioned to the word tara there. Every sloka contains either ka or ra. So Acharya says, read together, you will get taranam or crossing over the ocean of samsara. The Padastuti is at the beginning in this text as also in Srimad Bhagavatam. Reason is obvious. At least you see this, you will be interested to read. Of course, there is not a very correct explanation, but we call it as attraction. Suppose the doctor wants to give you a bitter pill. He will give you some sweets and along with that the bitter pill. Like that, the Parasuti is actually not very important, because Parasuti means he will get prosperity in this world, in this life. What is the use of that? That is not going to help you to get into moksha. But anyway, this is what is called as Arthavada in our system. They will tell you, if you do that, you will get that. One person will do. At least after some time, he will know, this is not important, I should go for higher values. So, both in Srimad Bhagavata and also in this Devi Bhagavata, you find the Parashruti is the opening thing. They call it Devi Bhagavata Mahatmyam. There, Srimad Bhagavata Mahatmyam. Now, one sloka you will read from there. Sarva Shastra Set Saram Tattva Vakshyami Sheshataha. Sudha Puranika says to the sages who are assembled in the Naimisharanya. The Naimisharanya world is a very significant world. It appears all the sages wanted to go to a place which will be by itself holy. There are some places which are by itself holy. You find in the Narada Bhukti Sutra. Sirti Gurvandi Sirtani Sukarmi Gurvandi Karmani Shastri Gurvandi Shastrani. All tirthas are not great. Ganges is great means doesn't mean that all other tirthas are great. So there are certain things which have got an innate value or making you more spiritually oriented. So like that, places are there. That is called the Kshetra Vishesha. So they wanted to know where they can go and listen to all these things of the Pauranika, who is Sudha. So they took a wheel and then they rolled it. Wherever it becomes completely smashed, that is the place. Nemihi yatra shiryate naimisham. Naimishari. So that is where this is described by Sudha Puranika to all the sages assembled there. He says this. Tavat garchanti tirthani puranani pradanita. Going to all sacred places and all that, okay. Puranas, okay. Vratas, okay. These are all things that normally are prescribed to be done for spiritual uplift. But they have got a limitation, because Yavati Suyade Samyaki Devi Bhagavatam Nadehi. Till you listen to Devi Bhagavatam, all these things are good. Suppose you don't listen to Devi Bhagavatam, these are all right for you. But the moment you start listening to Devi Bhagavatam, these things fail into insignificance. The indication that all these things are necessary, but then there is something superior to that, better than that. And what is that? That is Devi Bhagavatam.
தாவத் பாபாடவீன்றி நாம் கிளேசதா அபத்ரகண்டகா யாவன்ன பரிசு புரோப்ராப்தோ தேவி பாகவதாதிதா. பரிசு இஸ் ஆக்ஸ். தேவி பாகவதா இஸ் கன்சிடர்ட் டு பி அன் ஆக்ஸ் விச் இஸ் கட் டவுன் ஆல் த ஃபாரஸ்ட் விச் கம்போஸ் ஆஃப் சின்ஸ் அண்ட் பேட் ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ் கிளேசம் ஆல் சஃபரிங் and Abhadra Kantaka, inauspicious thorns. Thorns are considered to be inauspicious. All the forests are because of sins committed by people. So all these things are there till Parashu Praptaha. Till you get an axe. And what is that axe? Devi Bhagavatam. If you have Devi Bhagavatam, that is the axe which will cut down a forest of sins and also all your suffering. And inauspicious thorns in the way. These are all indicators and symbolism of progress in spirituality. This occurs as the first skanda, first sloka, adhyaya, 9 and 10 sloka. Why I showed this is, these are the texts when they open both Devi Bhagavata and also Srimad Bhagavata, give you the Bhagavata Mahatmyam. The word Bhagavatam itself is indicated of bhakti only. It's a story or episodes of Bhagavatas. Who are Bhagavatas? Bhaktas. Not only ordinary Bhaktas. Bhaktas of a very high and specialized variety. So that is what it is. So we have to go into full details of it. Divine Mother falls on all of us because of her grace for our own happiness here and the hereafter. That is the reason why we have to work to this text, meditate on that, practice whatever the disciplines that they lay. Of course, the instructions and guidance of an acharya who knows all this. Therefore, I think stop here, profoundly thanking Lord AGR for educating me in this text, to some extent, and all the devotees of Abhinav Vidya Sangha. Have given me this opportunity so that I hope to that extent my friends would have been from here to Guru Pyotma. So I wanted to share, sir, my presentation of today.
Thank you very much, sir. We enjoyed your detailed aspect of the speech. We bow down with respect to you, sir. Har Har Mahadev. Har Har Mahadev.
I'm not able to hear, sir. No audibility here. This is full.
Thank you, sir.
But if you have been useful, at least one by millions of what is to be said, I am grateful. So any questions and all?